sexual encounter with a particular body as being a fulfillment of something, whatever it is, and to think about the erotic dimensions of other aspects of our life. So, you know, when you were, you know, I think to have maybe different kinds of play or utopianism in the scholarly work that we expect students to do. I don't know, that sounds sort of Pollyannish or something like that, but to de-link this separation of work and sex, and then to have sex be part of this attachment to the real, I think is part of the problem or something, if that makes sense.
And I think, you know, to some extent, I mean, that sort of model was there with, you know, I don't know, with some psychoanalytic thinkers who, like Marcuse, right, for example, right? So, you know, Marxist, I mean, there was sort of the whole sense of sex as liberatory was that it was also, you know, libidinally there in everything that we do. And so, you know, that sort of, in a sense, it marked an unhinging of repression in all sorts of arenas in our lives. And that's, you know, that's one of the ways, one of the reasons why sex and public sex became something that was sort of a marker of liberation, right? So, I mean, I think that now we have a whole different kind of relationship to an understanding of repression, and part of it, sure, is about a certain kind of policing of subjectivity that happens at sort of at every level. So I mean, you know, I'm with Kathy that there needs to be some kind of form of thinking about what a utopian possibility like sex was, right, in for Marcuse, right? I mean, it was, you know, it was supposed to unhinge a whole load of things, right? And it feels, I mean, I'm also sort of curious about the idea of neoliberalism in bullying and cyberbullying and homophobia in particular, because, you know, on one level, I sort of think, you know, one of the things that's interesting about the new media circulation about this is, in some ways, you know, there's very pointed homophobic cyberbullying going on. Alongside that, there's also total indifference to people's lives, right? Which I think is part of a kind of don't ask, don't tell culture, to it, sort of encouraged indifference in some ways. And so, you know, in a sense, it's like a stupid, thoughtless, idiotic activity to just sort of broadcast this stuff. And yes, it I mean, I'm not saying at all that it's not pointed and homophobic. Of course it is, right? Of course it's that, and it would have completely different repercussions if this was a heterosexual act that was broadcast. I didn't dispute that at all. But I also think that there's a kind of indifference that has been made. Well, I mean, I suppose it's easier to make an indifferent attitude harmful through this kind of form of social media. I mean, it seems to me to be part of the sort of neoliberalism, right? That it's,
And in 1970, that would have been
Well, I mean, I think it's also, you know, it shows the way also in which tolerance is part of neoliberal culture, right? I mean, that it's part of the liberal framework that doesn't necessarily solve any question of rampant homophobia at all, but actually redirects it through other kinds of media that are available.
I was just thinking about how I've evolved this whatever philosophy for everyone over the years, but how dangerous that can be if you're not doing an active intervention in moments.
Right, absolutely.
Yeah. Are there other things that people would like to bring up? Yes.
Well, this is switching topics, but I was curious. I didn't follow the story of the list. Mm-hmm. Do you know what the reaction was by the young men who were exposed?
Depends on how they're arranged.
Through litigation or otherwise, kind of silence or police that discourse or reestablish kind of masculine power structures. I'm just curious. I haven't followed this.
Well, I think there has been a bit of repainting the men as victimized by this, and some.
Depends on how they're presented, right?
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah, I guess so.
Right.
Unfair.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
then,
but it also seems like that some of them met, just reading her account, that they were like, well, how am I all of this?
Yeah, they were. Well, they all posed for the pictures.
Oh, I thought that those were
just regular snapshots, maybe? Okay.
I think she got those pictures elsewhere.
Just from the phone.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, this is one of the really interesting things about specifically the representations of the men in this PowerPoint, because all the pictures are taken from dupe websites.
That's true. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
that's a good point.
Photographs of men that were on public websites, the pictures weren't taken from their Facebooks. So her way of representing them is part of their sports identity. It was a big part of how they factored it.
Mm-hmm.
In
if it's still there.
I forward it to you.
My first reaction was, I wish someone, my students would spend that much time on assault. I know that is very, very much the instructor in me speaking, but it was very fun. Mm-hmm. And well written and interesting.
I think a lot of the parents were
You mean the parents of the boys?
Yeah,
yeah.
Right.
I don't know what the girls' parents are.
I mean, just one other thing that I wanted to sort of, you know, bring up on the question of race and new media also, and because it seems to me that in a sense there's some people have been writing about how, you know, what used to take the place of race has been sort of transformed into technology now, right? And there's a way in which sort of the technology sort of creates a there's both a kind of fantasy space there, but also that in a sense the affect of technology is like the affect of racial difference almost. That machines themselves now have they give off affect themselves. They're not just transmitting human affects. And it seems to me that the question of racial difference needs to be sort of thought through that in some way. I mean, I know that in the Rutgers case, there was a big march that was about justice, not retribution, right? And I think that was, I mean, I know, you know, some people who were circulating that list, and I don't think it was, to my mind, but you may know more, and maybe you're thinking about other kinds of frameworks too. To my mind, it seemed as if it was more about trying to address the kind of personalization of an accusation rather than addressing a larger culture. So I didn't think it was about sort of thinking about different kinds of equivalent equivalent attacks or equivalent equivalent histories of violence or whatever. But maybe you're thinking about different sorts of things and not that much.
No, you're absolutely right. I mean, I guess it's just that, you know, I think personally for me, it felt like there's a fine line.
Right.
You know, between sort of saying that, you know, these are kids that have grown up in a culture. And
right.
Where does sort of their life of responsibility fall? I mean,
right.
You can't just say that they've picked it up or vacuum.
Right. And everyone's grown up in a culture.
Right.
You
exactly.
Know,
exactly. So it's just.
Right.
You know, I mean, I'm absolutely agreeing
right.
with that.
Right.
That's true. Maybe not at the moment. Right? I mean, you know, it seems like the kind of conversation that one has about a lot of hate speech, right? But it's very difficult to analyze. It also sort of goes to what Sean was saying about the movement towards juridical understanding of the arena of sex, which is problematic at least, right? But yeah. Yes.
Well, I think just in relation to the juridical dimension of sexuality, I thought one of the things that's really interesting with the New York Times article about the Karen Owen's PowerPoint was that they were interviewing students, and students said they were having difficulty that they say, like, we don't even know who the victim is here.
Mm-hmm.
That's the difficulty, that there has to be a victim. There has to be, you know, which was easier, and these records
mm-hmm.
signed.
Right.
I think one of the things that was really confounding about that for people, and perhaps why it earned so much attention, was that it sort of defied a lot of, you know, more popular discourses we have about sexuality.
Right. Right, yeah. That's very interesting. Yes, but, you know, and again, it's a way of avoiding the question of pleasure, right, which is always, I mean, you know, because the question of pleasure is just really difficult to address, whether it's good sex or bad sex, violent sex or
not violent. You know, I mean, it's just one of those very sort of difficult. So, you want to say something? Then we should probably.
Yeah, just actually, this goes back to something you asked at the start about if these media forms are quantitative or qualitative differences.
Mm-hmm.
You know, obviously, our lives have always been mediated.
Right.
I wonder if it's a quantitative difference that makes a qualitative difference.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when you're, I don't even know how to get my head around these social media forms. And when you grow up in an era where, you know, you're sort of, it's ubiquitous and you're completely saturated with these sort of forms of social media, there's no kind of training mechanisms or like kind of awareness or outreach on how to kind of navigate these spaces, and I just wonder if this is kind of indicative of growing pains, and that we haven't kind of figured out sort of like all the, you know, maybe you need like the things of the bus that say, you know, be careful when you drink or something. I mean, I don't want to sound kind of reactionary here because I'm not, but just to have mechanisms to kind of make people aware of how to live in these public-private spheres where those distinctions no longer hold.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
sort of, you know, train.
Uh-huh.
Because adults as well as youth are sort of still figuring
out. Right, absolutely.
I think sort of that, you know, the exclusion of the adults is their version of don't trust anybody over 30. I mean, I kind of think that that's functioning. And I don't even hack, I don't know how to tweet. I was on Facebook for 6 months and drove me nuts. And, you know, I mean, I think that's how culture works. That, that there are age differences in communities, and you know, if you can transgress those through your savvy, that's cool. But you know, this is new world, so some of us aren't going to fit in and aren't going to be leaders.
Interestingly, Twitter is the most popular with people over 30. It's not actually a youth market.
Is that right?
Yeah, that's true.
But
a lot of geeks
and
conferences.
Facebook has moved from being, I mean, if you've seen the movie, right? It's moved from the university to, I mean, his grandfather just asked me to be a Facebook friend.
But there's a lot of evidence that older people are not.
I still think your point is like really valid.
But the thing is that they're not in these exclusionary spaces anymore either. Like there is.
I don't think that there are exclusionary spaces, and I do agree that there is seepage, but that the being ahead of the technological curve is one way you're defining your, you know, where you're able to be in the inquiry, and that is functioning to, you know, preserve categories.
Yeah, I guess the anxiety that I have with the, you know, this neoliberal wired culture is that